just one word. You calm the storm that surrounds me. Just one word. The darkness has to retreat.
Okay.
Just one touch. Just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Praise the name that makes a way.
There's How are you?
Faith arrives, let all agree, there's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe for greater things, there's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree, there's no power. Fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe
safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms, I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arms, I'm leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all of.
Good morning, St. Peter's. We're gathered together because of his wonderful love. So let's sing together.
As we come to your presence, we remember every blessing that you poured out so freely from above. Lifting gratitude and praise,
Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to worship today at St. Peter's by the Sea. Whether you're out on the patio, and I think we have a few, out in the internet, or here in the sanctuary, we're so glad you're here, and we hope this time of worship provides encouragement for your soul. We've got some announcements this morning. It's our birthday, the 29th birthday of this church's charter, and we'll have a cake out on the patio. We can enjoy and fellowship with each other. Next Sunday is going to be Meet Your Deacon Sunday. We've had to postpone that, and now it's here. Come and put a face with a name, and also fellowship with the people in your parish. Coming up on October 1st, at 10 o'clock to noon in the boathouse, the Sisters by the Sea Pearl Pod is hosting a gathering. The topic is creating and spreading inspiration, and our featured presenter is Audie Stanton, doing some artistic things with us. No reservations required, just come and join in. There is an information sheet at the back of the sanctuary if you'd like to read that on your way out and bring it with you. If you are in need of prayer, we will have the prayer teams up in the front after worship. Please take advantage of that. It's a very valuable thing for us. And as always, if you want to find out what's happening, the best way to do that is to sign up for our Thursday email at www.stpetershb.org. This morning, after the call to worship, we're going to be singing a new song. It's contemporary. It's very catchy. We think that you'll like it. And the worship team chose it because the lyrics really tie in with our new series, sermon series that Steve's going to be doing. So if you're not comfortable singing, reflect on the words. I think that you'll really see how it ties into what we'll be learning. I think it'll become an earworm for you. It's very catchy, and we hope that you like it. And now, if you're able, please stand and join me for the call to worship. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth.
Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into God's presence with singing.
Know that the Lord is God.
It is He that made us, and we are His.
We are His people,
and the sheep of His pasture.
Enter His gates with thanksgiving,
and His courts with praise.
Give thanks to Him. Bless His name.
For the Lord is good.
His steadfast love endures forever.
And His faithfulness to all generations.
It all comes down to this. What you require of me. Love my neighbor as myself. And you above all things, act justly, love mercy, walk humbly with you, God. In all things, in all ways, walk humbly with you, God. It all comes down to this, to be your hands and feet, good news to all the world, and the truth will set us free. Act justly, love mercy, walk humbly with you, God. Just like the sea,
You may be seated. In our journey as Christians, we seek to be the best version of ourselves in Jesus' likeness. We, of course, fall short, and we refuse to surrender ourselves fully at times, but God's grace covers us and reconciles us to Himself. Please join me with the prayer of confession and a small moment of silence afterwards. Father in heaven, we thank you for the freedom you have given us through life, death, and resurrection of your Son. But we confess today that we often live like slaves. Instead of living like you delight in us, we avoid you in shame and guilt. Instead of receiving your favor as a gift, we try to earn it with our efforts. Instead of pursuing your purposes, we cling to your short-sighted agendas. Forgive us, embrace us, cleanse us, heal us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. Through God's grace, we are all forgiven. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
You know, sometimes I am a little bit jealous of more traditional churches that have liturgies, and you know, I don't necessarily want to wear the big mitre hat of an Episcopalian, but some of the liturgy really can be helpful. And one thing that I've seen, if you've ever been in a Catholic service, where they walk around and they splash the water on everyone. And I think that's kind of cool because it reminds us that it's in the waters of baptism that God lays claim to us. And so we've got the font before us today as a reminder that that's how we enter. We enter through the grace of Jesus Christ that claims us as his own, both in our dying and in our rising to new life. And it's this blessing, it's this sacrament that actually empowers us through life. And so this morning, we're going to be receiving new leaders in the church, new elders and deacons to stand and take a position of service. And they do so by remembering their baptism, by reclaiming the way that God claimed them. This isn't an extra blessing for a chosen few, but rather this is a fulfillment of what we're invited into in the way of Jesus in serving others. He said, I've not come to be served, but to serve and to give my life as a ransom for many. And so too, as people are responding to God's call to service, it's simply a fulfillment of what begins here. And so this morning, I want to have us join together in a little bit of liturgy back and forth as we remind ourselves of God's grace. Will you join me in response? There are varieties of gifts, but it is the same Spirit who gives them. God works through each person in a unique way. but it is God's purpose that is accomplished. Together we are the body of Christ and individually members of it. We are called into the church of Jesus Christ by baptism and are marked as Christ's own by the Holy Spirit. Ordination is Christ's gift to the church, assuring us that his ministry continues among us. Through ordination, God provides for acts of care and compassion in the world, for the ordering and governance of the church, and for the preaching of the word and the celebration of the sacraments. That's it. I'm never quite sure, you know, my part, your part. So that's it. With that, as we continue the service, I want to invite Shelley Thanell, our clerk of session, to come forward, and those of you who know that your position is up here. So let's make your way forward.
Representing the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, the session of St. Peter's by the Sea Presbyterian Church installs to active service those who have been previously ordained, deacons Marlene Reed, Susie Sampson, and Heidi Swidrack, and elder Dan Dawes.
As we press on in faithfulness to Christ, these leaders have answered God's call to service. Let us all reaffirm our baptismal vows, renouncing all that opposes God and God's rule, and affirming the faith of the Holy Catholic Church. And so let me ask you who are standing for leadership to answer these questions that we ask as people come forward for baptism. Trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the way of sin and renounce evil and its power in this world? If so, answer, I do.
I do.
And who is your Lord and Savior? Amen. And will you be Christ's faithful disciples, obeying his word and showing his love? Amen. So with that, we continue in as a reminder in the waters of baptism. And so we ask these questions that are the constitutional questions that every Presbyterian elder and every Presbyterian deacon has answered throughout our history. And so too all across the country and around the world. And so you join a community of servants in serving the Lord. And so let me ask you, dear friends, in baptism you are claimed by God's love, clothed in the grace of Jesus Christ, and anointed with the gifts of the Holy Spirit to share Christ's mission in the world. And I realize I just took your part. That was a good part, though. I'll stick with the orange, because that otherwise we'll totally throw it off. We all have different gifts. Now you are called by God's grace through the voice of the church for new service and ministry in Jesus' name. In accordance with the Constitution of the Presbyterian Church USA, show your commitment to this calling by responding to these questions. Do you trust in Jesus Christ, your Savior, acknowledge him Lord of all and head of the church, and through him believe in the one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit?
Do you accept the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be the Holy Spirit, the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ in the church universal and God's word to you?
And do you sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic and reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by those confessions as you lead the people of God?
Amen.
Will you fulfill your office in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions?
Will you be governed by our church's polity, and will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit?
Will you, in your own life, seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world?
And do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church?
Will you seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love?
And this question is in particular for the deacons. Will you be a faithful deacon, teaching charity, urging concern, and directing the people's help to the friendless and those in need? In your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? Amen.
And to you, Dan, will you be a faithful elder, watching over the people, providing for their worship, nurture, and service? Will you share in government and discipline, serving in governing bodies of the church, and in your ministry, will you show the love and the justice of Jesus Christ? Do we, the community of faith known as St. Peter's by the Sea, accept these brothers and sisters as deacons and elders chosen by God through the voice of the congregation that lead us in the way of Jesus Christ?
All right. And do we, the community of faith, agree to encourage them to respect their decisions and to follow them as they guide us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is head of the church? And with that, we take a time to pray over them. We'll be anointing them with oil, just as a reminder of the power and the blessing of the Holy Spirit. We'll pray for each and then surround them. Then I'll offer a general prayer to conclude. I'd like to invite any currently serving deacons and elders or former deacons and elders to come gather around them. If you guys will take just a few steps out, that'll let people be able to crowd around you. And if there happens to be more of us up here than there are out there, that's okay too. We want to all be praying together. If we can take a picture so that our nominating committee can see eligible servants here, that would be great. So let's pray. Lord God, thank you for the power of your Holy Spirit. As we anoint these with oil, reminded of the tradition of Israel, Lord, that it was the oil that flowed, the oil that was a reminder as it ran down the beard of Aaron. In Psalm 133, behold, and how good and pleasant it is when brothers and sisters dwell together in unity, that it brings glory to you. Lord, we ask that you would continue to empower, to lift up, to raise, to encourage, so that these leaders might reach out to those who are in need, that they might chart a course forward for our church, that we, Lord, would be all that you've called us to be. Thank you, Lord, for the gift of your Spirit. Thank you for the gift of life that we have in Jesus Christ. May we not be a community that seeks only for ourselves, but may we be a people that serve and love the world around us so they might see the reality of life that is found in Jesus Christ. Lord, we ask all of this in the precious name of our Lord Jesus. We pray this in your name. Amen. 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 All right. Welcome. God bless you.
Thanks.
Yeah. Bless you. Bless you, Marlene. Have to make sure that I get my part right. I know what it is, though, because we have our choir back, huh? Are we excited about that? It's good to have these voices. So with that, as we prepare to bring before the Lord our tithes and offerings, let me offer this prayer. Lord, we ask that you would bless us, Lord, with your presence, that you would bless us with all the resources that we need, that as we offer these gifts to you, Lord, that you'd be glorified in the giving. And we ask that in the music that we enjoy, that we might hear your voice encouraging us and calling us to serve you and you alone. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Lay up your treasures in heaven. Holy people, lay up your treasures in glory, where nothing in this world can take them away. Oh, listen, people, hear the Master say, come and lay up
treasures
in heaven. Lay up
treasures
in glory. Your treasures in this world will fade away, but the things of the Lord will last forevermore, forevermore. When the Lord looked down and saw the people there, tied up in worry and burdened with care, he said, seek first the kingdom and you will see the things that will last for eternity. Come and lay up in heaven, lay up in glory, where nothing in this world can take them away. Oh, listen, people, hear the Master say, come and lay up in heaven, lay up in glory. Your treasures in this world will fade away, but the things of the Lord will last forevermore, forevermore. Some people trust in their silver and gold. They put their faith in the wealth they hold. But fortunes will fade and kingdoms fall. So put your trust in the Lord.
As we prepare to come before the Lord in prayer, I just want to ground us a little bit. Sometimes it helps to have just a little bit of scripture in order to give focus to what we pray together. And this is one, I always think of this as both a garden and a building type of prayer. Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 3, "For this reason I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth takes its name. And I pray that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant that you may be strengthened in your inner being with power through his Spirit, and that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith as you are being rooted and grounded in love." I think when we look at the world today, one of the things that this world desperately needs, that this world needs from the people of God, is an extension of kindness. It is to take all of the fear, all of the anger, all of the frustration, and find a way to respond in a Christ-like way to bring about peace, to extend kindness, to let love reign. And so if we're going to be the people of God doing that, it takes an inner resolve. It takes strength that doesn't come from us, but strength that transcends and works through us. Today we have our team working in preparation for the resettlement of a refugee from the Ukraine. Five members of that team are going to be gathered together today for a good part of the day. And I just want to ask us to be praying for them. I think I've got all of these right. We've got Lisa Farmer. Where are you? She's outside. Are you outside, Lisa? We have Joyce Riddell. Where's Joyce? She's in the back row. She's back there too. I'm two for two strikes out. Dan Dawes, I know, is right there. Yeah. All right. Dan Dawes. And then we have Nadine? Nadine, what's your last name? Great. Nadine will be praying. And our fifth member is Heidi Swidrak. Where's Heidi? All right. Let's have all of you just stand right where you are, and we'll pray for you, and we're going to pray for even more. I should have let Lisa and Joyce know. They're probably conspiring something good. So let's pray. Lord, thank you for this team that has stepped forward to be overwhelmed in some ways by just a lot of information, knowing how we're going to process all the work ahead. But we ask, Lord, that this work would begin because of the moving of your Spirit. And so we ask that you would bless today this team, that as they begin to communicate with each other, that they would have a sense of cohesiveness, that they would know their individual responsibilities, but in all of it, Lord, that it would work to bring about the health and the safety and the wholeness of a family that's coming out of such a terrible crisis. And so, Lord, we pray for that region of the world. We ask that peace would prevail, but not just for there, Lord. We pray for all the places that it seems that there's so much hostility and frustration and anger. We pray, Lord, that we might stand in the love of Christ and that we might experience both your grace and also the generosity to share and to love and to not be a part of the madness, Lord, but to be a people of hope. And so, Lord, bless these today. Bless your church today. Bless us in all the work that we do, that as we come alongside one another and whatever need we have, Lord, may we know that all good things come from your generous hand. And so hear us as we seek to live and to pray as the disciples of Jesus, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So today we start a new series. The title of it is Disciples We Dare to Do. And I like that because there's this emphasis on the doing of our faith. One of the places that I really enjoy going from time to time is the Home Depot. Anybody else head to the Home Depot? Love the Home Depot. What is there not to love about the Home Depot? They, over the last 20 years, have had three different slogans. And the first, a long time ago, went like this: you can do it, we can help. I find that they kind of help, but not as much help as I sometimes need, but that's okay. You can do it. They're just cheering us on. You can do it, we can help. And then they shifted to saying this: more saving, more doing. So that's another one. But the latest one I'm a little iffy on. Maybe you've heard it: how doers get more done. What do you think? How doers get more done. But the thing about all of that is that there's a sense of a doing. Something gets done. Now, I do want to just tip you off. This is just a little helpful aside in the sermon. Have you ever gone to the Home Depot and you get all that you think you need, and then you go home and you're working on your project, and then you find out that it wasn't a half-inch bolt, it was 5/8 that you needed? And you're like, oh, and then you've got to go back to Home Depot and you hope you get the right one, and then you go back home. I have solved that, okay? I'm offering this for free today. This is what you do. No matter what your project is, let's say it's plumbing or electrical, you just go to that aisle and you buy everything, okay? You buy it all. Buy the 5/8, buy the 1/4 inch, buy the 1/2 inch, get them all, because you don't know which one it really is. You think you do, but chances are, you're wrong. And you're going to be at home saying, oh, it doesn't fit. But if you buy the whole shelf, then you'll have everything you need. And then you're guaranteed to have only two trips to Home Depot: your original purchase trip, and then when you take it all back. And they're so nice. They're really nice. They'll always take it back. And so just a little tip, save you some time there. But it's all about doing, right? We think of, like, do it yourself. There's a lot of things that we have to fix around the house, but I want to say this as we look at this theme and consider it: Christianity is not do it yourself. It's just not. It can't be. Christianity is not do it yourself. It's all about you, or what you can do, or what you can fix. And that's where I want us to not think so much about Home Depot. That's why the slogan for Lowe's, I think, is better. For a long time, it went like this: let's build something together. That's good, isn't it? Let's build something together. I imagine Jesus when he was going to the fishermen on the Sea of Galilee, and he said, hey, come follow me and I will make you fishers of people. If Jesus was going to a gathering of carpenters, he would go to them and say, let's build something together. So there's this sense of an invitation, an inviting to life. And so we have to consider our doing. How is your doing? We often ask that as a question: how are you doing? And that means, like, what's all going on in your life? And in relation to your faith, how are you doing? What kind of doing is happening? Now, we often center our faith and our understanding of the gospel in John 3:16. And I think that we always should. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have life eternal. Indeed, God didn't send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. One of the challenges is that our thinking in our Western world, in terms of belief, that it's often a belief in an idea rather than a belief that moves us to action. And so in the series, I want us to be thinking about disciples we dare to do. There's a sense that we take the belief that we have, that God's love for the world continues, and we act on it. We do something about it. And as we do something about it, we experience an explosion or an expansion of that love as we live our lives in faith. And so it sounds, right, it sounds really clear when we read John 3:16, and then we say, okay, well, we're going to be following Jesus. And then we come to passages like Luke chapter 16, where we are today. And this is where we're starting. Luke chapter 16, I'm going to read it in the New Living Translation so that we might grab a particular phrase. Usually I read in the New Revised Standard, but today I want to read in this version. So hear now the word of the Lord. Jesus told this story to his disciples. There was a certain rich man who had a manager handling his affairs. One day a report came that the manager was wasting his employer's money. So the employer called him in and said, "What's this I hear about you? Get your report in order because you're going to be fired." The manager thought to himself, "Now what?" Now, this is the part of the translation I'm not in favor of. What it actually says is, "Oh, what should I do? What should I do? My boss has fired me. I don't have the strength to dig ditches, and I'm too proud to beg. Ah, I know how to ensure that I'll have plenty of friends who will give me a home when I'm fired." So he invited each person who owed money to his employer to come and discuss the situation. He asked the first one, "How much do you owe him?" The man replied, "I owe him 800 gallons of olive oil." So the manager told him, "Take the bill and quickly change it to 400 gallons. "And how much do you owe my employer?" he asked the next man. "I owe him 1,000 bushels of wheat," was the reply. "Here," the manager said, "take the bill and change it to 800 bushels. The rich man had to admire the dishonest rascal for being so shrewd. And it is true that the children of this world are more shrewd in dealing with the world around them than are the children of light. Here's the lesson. Use your worldly resources to benefit others and make friends. Then when your possessions are gone, they will welcome you to an eternal home. If you are faithful in little things, you will be faithful in large ones. But if you are dishonest in little things, you won't be honest with greater responsibilities. And if you are untrustworthy about worldly wealth, who will trust you with the true riches of heaven? And if you are not faithful with other people's things, why should you be trusted with things of your own? No one can serve two masters, for you will hate the one and love the other. You will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and be enslaved to money." The word of the Lord. The passage essentially is calling for singular devotion, but I don't know about you, but it is a perplexing, troubling, confusing. This is a story that Jesus tells? Does anybody else have this sense of like, where did this come from? You know, a few months back during the season of Lent, we read through the Gospel of Luke from beginning to end all the way through. And I know that as we did it week after week, there were sections of scripture that made us all uncomfortable, that we kind of said like, whoa, I don't think I've heard that before. And you probably haven't heard it because we typically don't read that on a Sunday morning. And yet it's what Jesus has to say. And how do we then wrestle with it in such a way that we can come to a place of understanding what it is he's trying to get us to see? Because so often what we think of a parable being just this nice story that kind of gives you an illustration of either what you need to do or maybe what you need to avoid. But in this case, this dishonest rascal is the hero of the story. And so we might wonder, what in the world are we supposed to walk away with? How are we supposed to understand this? And I think it's all part of the way of Jesus in terms of our sometimes a Sunday school mentality that keeps us locked into not recognizing how often Jesus had this edge to him. Jesus had a whole lot more confrontation, a whole lot more challenge that we, I think, need to wrestle with as adults seeking to follow Jesus. This certainly isn't the kind of Sunday school lesson that we're going to be able to unfold for children to help them know how to cheat. But yet, what is it that Jesus is driving at here? I think he's speaking with a kind of wisdom similar to what he encounters when he gets to Jerusalem. Luke chapter 20, it says that as he's there, the religious leaders are coming around him and demanding to know the authority by which he's doing these things. And I love the way that Jesus shrewdly answers. This word shrewd can be prudent or wise. Jesus answers by saying this, Huh, tell you what, I'll answer your question if you answer mine. And he says, John's baptism, was it from heaven or was it just from the people? And the leaders go away and they discuss among themselves, how can they answer? Because if they say it was from heaven, he's going to ask us why we didn't believe. But if we say from the people, you know, they regard him as a prophet and we don't want to, you know, jeopardize our own standing among them. So they come back to Jesus and they say, well, we don't know. Jesus says, well, then I'm not going to answer you. Just seems fair, doesn't it? He's kind of laying that sense of rather than being trapped by it, he's keeping ahead of the game. Happens also in the same chapter when they come and they say, with this great deference, you teach the way of God and you know, are always committed to truth. So we just have this one question. Is it right to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Boy, answering that wrong can get you in a whole hot water with the governing authorities. And what does Jesus say? Bring me a coin. Whose face? Whose title is this? Oh, Caesar? Wow. Then give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and to God what belongs to God. These are all examples of a way of operating that's a shrewd way of thinking, a prudent, a wise way of engaging, so that Christ, Jesus, might come clarify for us what it means to live with God as our singular devotion. Now, we might have some ideas of the takeaway of the story we've just read. It could be that Jesus is trying to help us know how to cheat your employer and feel good about it. Yeah, probably not. Another possibility, the honor of dishonest behavior. Is that what he's driving at? The honor of dishonest behavior? No. How about this? Crime doesn't pay, but sometimes it does. I mean, they're really all options. They're all possibilities. And that's part of the reason I have always avoided preaching on this passage. So I've been in ministry for, I don't know, a lot of years. This is the first time I've ever said, okay, I'm going to take this one on. I'm going to try to wrestle with it and figure out what it means. And I have to be honest with you. The person I sat down with and read carefully the commentary was Justo Gonzalez. He wrote a great commentary on Luke's gospel, and spending time with that, it was just great to feel like I have some sense of where it might go. And it's music to my ears. Someone has a cell phone that's going off. I'm not sure where, but it's close by. But all of it is this sense of how do we live with as adult disciples that face the complexity of life, and in facing that complexity, find ourselves following Jesus faithfully. What Justo Gonzalez says is that we've got to look at the parable of the dishonest rascal and compare and contrast it with the story of the rich fool that we find in Luke chapter 12. I preached on that text at the end of July. The rich fool. Both are coming with circumstances that are somewhat similar but slightly different. The rich fool, remember, he had an abundance of crops. The land produced abundantly, and he is in a place of not knowing what to do next. And the circumstance of the rascal is simply this, that he has an abundance that he is soon to lose. And so decisions need to be made. And that's the question they both ask. And that's what the connection between these two are. The question of what should I do? And that's a great question, isn't it? We're always asking that question. In life, what should I do? Given the current circumstances, given all that's going on, given the inflation, we've probably in the last few months asked ourselves the question, what should we do? How do we respond personally to this? And not only asking the question of what should we do, that question also is embedded in the opening song that we sang today, the one that says, act justly, love mercy, walk humbly. Because in Micah chapter 6, verse 8, it's cast in the form of a question. He has told you, O mortal, what is good and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? That's what you're asked to do. And so when we ask ourselves the question, what are we to do? I think that that's the clarity that we need. This is what we're all about, a people who seek justice, who demonstrate kindness, and walk with God in humility. The rich fool asks the question, what should he do? And he comes up with a solution that he devised. He said, here's the answer, bigger barns. I've got all this abundance. I know what I'll do. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones. Now, the rascal is answering that question in some slightly different ways. He's saying, what should I do? You know, I'm not that strong, so I don't think digging is going to really be a good occupation for me. And I'm a little bit too proud, and so begging won't work either. And so he arrives at this solution in verse 4, where he simply says, I know how to ensure that I'll have plenty of friends who will give me a home when I'm fired. So he comes up with this plan. And in coming up with a plan, that's his solution. Now, we've got to recognize that there's a big difference between the mindset of the rich fool and the person in Luke chapter 16. The mindset of the fool is to say, all of this belongs to me. I own it. I can do what I want with it. And yet in chapter 16, we see this idea of a steward. I'm in charge of it. I don't own it. I don't possess it. It's not for my use, but rather it's for the blessing of the community. So by paring the pricing down, he's bringing blessing to the community around him. Now, we might say, well, that doesn't seem fair or right. That's not honest. And yet, even in verse 8, we see that it's the rich man had to admire the dishonest rascal for being so shrewd. The person who owned it all comes to the conclusion like, that was a pretty good move. Have to admit. Probably should have let him go right away rather than giving a little bit of notice. But what Jesus is pushing is he's saying, like, this is so that the abundance wouldn't be held by one, but it would be shared by all. And I think that's the difference. The difference is the assumption of the rich fool is that the future is all going to be just like it's been in the past. Tomorrow is going to be the same as the next day and the same as the next day. And yet in chapter 16, what we see is that a new order is coming. A new order is coming. Something new is emerging. Situations, circumstances change, and there's a sense of urgency in terms of what needs to be done. And that new order is part of the unfolding of God's kingdom, that we often live our lives in such a way that we think, oh, it's all going to be just like it was yesterday, and tomorrow will be the same more. And yet something new is coming as followers of Jesus, that we're arranging our lives and rearranging our lives for a bigger purpose, so that our lives might be singular devotion, that God's priorities above our own. Because walk with me, this is a little bit of Justo Gonzalez bringing this. I thought it was pretty smart. We all agree on certain things, right? We agree that life is short. How many are on board with that, right? Life is short. I don't care where you are on the spectrum. Life is short, and however much you've got, we always feel like, a little bit more. I want more. It's short, but, you know, we're all kind of doing all we can to get as much as we can, and that's a good thing. So if life is short, and then the second thing we agree with is you can't take it with you. We know what that means, right? You can't take it with you. So when it's over, it's over. And so what you've done in this time is all you can do. So if life is short and you can't take it with you, and you in your mindset say, so what I'm going to do is just relax and enjoy it. And if that's the perspective, then you're not any wiser than the rich fool who came to that conclusion himself. In contrast to that, think about this dishonest rascal. He says, I'm going to find a way to turn the circumstances and bring blessing to others. And yes, I'm going to benefit from it, likely. But that's the lesson that Jesus draws. And that's what's so surprising to me. Jesus says this in the translation, New Living Translation. It says, here's the lesson. Use your worldly resources to benefit others and make friends. Wow. That's an interesting way to tell the story, isn't it? That he tells this story of a dishonest servant, and he does it in such a way to say, like, get smart about it. Find ways that you can actually bring this about, because a new order is coming. And I think that's the challenge for us. How do we give thought to the way that we're spending, the way that we're saving, the way that we're giving, so that we do it in such a way that it honors God? Because we can't serve two masters, though we often try, right? You can't serve God and money. You can't be enslaved by it. And serving the Lord, God wants freedom. One of the quotes I really appreciate is from John Wesley. He said this: do all the good you can by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as you can. Isn't that a good reminder for us? This is what we're to be about. Doing all of that. If we put it in the language of the series, we would say, disciples dare to do all the good we can. Disciples dare to do by all the means available to us. Disciples dare to do in all the places we find ourselves. Disciples dare to do at all times and to all people. And disciples dare to do as long as we live. That's what life is all about. The singular devotion. Recognize that we can't do it. We heard it sung so beautifully by the choir. And rather than walking away and saying, oh, that was a nice anthem, let's respond to it. Lay up your treasures in heaven. Do the things that are beyond yourself for the good of the world around us, so that others might be experiencing the blessing of heaven through us. And I know it's a challenge. It's a challenge for me. Try to figure out the balance of that. Where am I seeing where God is moving, and how can I also invest myself in that work? And so it's not so much just about fixing the stuff around our house. Home Depot's a great place to hang out when you have plumbing problems and get what you need. But even more so, this community of faith where we are together, friends, let's build something together with God's help. Amen? Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this community. Thank you for your love. Thank you for all the resources that surround us. What we ask for is the faith to see. We ask for the kind of belief that will empower us to action. We ask that we might see you, Jesus, moving among us, using us to touch the world around us, not with a love that is our own, but rather a love that is inspired by you. And so grant us wisdom and grant us courage for the living of these days. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Dear friends, let's stand together for our closing hymn.
Story.
shame our wanton selfish gladness, rich in things and poor in soul. Dear friends, let's be rich in soul. That was the accusation against the rich fool, that he wasn't rich toward God. People, let's be rich toward God, rich in the things of God, rich in the work of God, so that God's love might flow through us to a world around us. I am glad to say that we'll be singing verse 4 of that hymn and bring it to a better resolution, a little more encouragement on the way. But friends, as we go forth from this place, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship, the courage of the Holy Spirit, be with us this day and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.